Kevin, do you like dubstep?
Sure do.
Well, then you're going to love this week's sponsor, because this week's sponsor is about dropping the bass. Are you ready for this?
Go!
Let's do it!
Oh, let's go. Here it comes. Oh. It's building up.
Oh, did I tell you about... Yeah, I told you how my buddy was like, you guys should do an episode about A Star Is Born. I was like, we should.
Yes, and I really, really, really want to watch that. I was thinking about going this week, but I've just been working too late, so I didn't fucking do it.
Yeah, there's no way. I have not been able to do it after work. And then I was like, I could do it Friday, but Friday nights are always when people... go see movies, so I don't really want to fight a crowd. And then I could do it Saturday early morning.
Yeah, do it early Saturday. Yeah, those are always nice.
But yeah, the wedding is at 3, so I don't know
and
if
you
I'd
have
be
to
able
travel.
To. Yeah, so I don't know if I'll be able to do that. But then I was like, Sunday, but no, I'll be watching football.
Sunday.
So maybe sometime next week I'll go see it. Because that'd be cool. I mean, we could do that next week and then move Coulter Wall to the week after the Halloween one.
Yeah, we could do that.
Yeah, I might just do that. All right. Anyway, hello, everyone. Welcome to the Hodge Podcast, the official podcast of CountryHodgePodge.com. I am your host and cult leader, Steve Hodge. And joining me, as always, is a different cult leader, my co-host, cousin, and lover, Kevin Hodge.
I certainly will be drinking that poisoned Kool-Aid.
Yeah, America. Everyone join us. So this week, we wanted to do something different. Because, one, we were deciding what artist to do, and then we didn't really want to rush into someone's discography to be like, to just pull together a top. So thinking about this idea for...
Fishing.
We were thinking about this idea for a while, so we're going to start a new... If you notice, this episode's not episode 79 or whatever we're at now. It's Legends 1. We're going to do a new series where every once in a while, instead of an episode about a current like artist you should be listening to or you know someone who's still making music, we're going to talk about legends who may have passed or else like Willie Nelson's not dead yet, but we might do like, an episode on him. And just like people who have just chiseled their name in stone as a legend. So,
undisputed legend status.
Yeah, because...
You know?
If this is your first episode, hello and goodbye.
Sup.
But,
peace.
we did this podcast because we want to introduce people to artists that are out there that aren't on the radio that you should be listening to. And if they are on the radio, you should be listening to other songs that aren't on the radio by them. Like Jason Aldean surprisingly has a good song. So does Luke Bryan.
Yep.
So does even Keith Urban. As much as Kevin does not want to admit that.
That is a contentious point.
But so there are artists out there that they're on the radio who have crap or they're obviously crappy, but they have good music. And then obviously there's artists out there that aren't being played on the radio that we want to talk about. Like last week we did Dalton Domino. The week before that we talked to Jamie Lynn Wilson. We were able to talk with her about kind of the state of country music and her new album, and it was awesome. But but artists like this, especially our generation and younger, we were talking about, like, it's crazy how there are shirts out there that say, like, I grew up on 90s country. It's like, well, that wasn't really always that good. Like, there's some... Because when people are like, I grew up on Shania, I'm like, well, she's a pop star. She's not a fucking country artist. Like, you can grow up on Shania all you want, but that was straight pop music. Because, man, I feel like a woman. That ain't fucking Mama Tried. That's just a dumpy fucking song. even though everyone, the second you hear, dan, 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 Everyone knows
it's the international white girls drunk at bar song.
Oh my god, that is the drunken karaoke. That song and Girls Just Want to Have Fun are the fucking drunken bachelorette karaoke
fucking
songs.
Love that shit. They brush their teeth to that shit.
Yeah, yeah. But so we wanted to do episodes about people you may not know. I mean, obviously, there are people out there where I say, like, they're like, oh, I like country music. Who's your favorite artist? To go, like, Waylon Jennings. And they're like, I don't know him. I'm like, he's mentioned in, like, every third fucking country song. Like, you have heard that name before. You know Waylon Jennings. You might not know his music, but you know he exists. And yeah. So there are artists like that. Like, I genuinely – or I remember one time I pointed out that – God, what song was it? It was some shitty pop song, and it mentioned Merle Haggard in it. And I just go – I tweeted out – I was back when I had a Twitter, and I tweeted out, like, fucking – who I don't know, Luke Bryan or whoever, mentioning Merle Haggard in a song, as if anyone from your fan base knows who Merle Haggard is. And
exactly. Like, there's people who know Merle Haggard's name and don't know anything about him just because of the fact that he's a common name drop.
Yeah.
And I feel like that's the other part about doing this Legends series that's kind of nice, is even if you're someone who doesn't really know them that well, hopefully the list of songs that we talk about later will be a good intro for you to fucking dive in. Because that's the other thing about the Legends, is they've got huge catalogs of music.
Yeah,
it's really intimidating to try to dive into.
Yeah, when I was looking at just Merle's songs today, I went to his Wikipedia page. He has 60 studio albums.
Yeah.
60.
Yeah, like, it's
what the fuck?
it's kind of terrifying to be like, oh, I'm just going to listen to Merle today. Maybe I'll get through an eighth of his music.
When we do these artists that have 4 or 5 albums, it's like, it's a day at work listening to their music and you get to hear it all. But Merle, I'd be sitting there for a week like, I don't even fucking know. And I texted you earlier like, oh, I just grabbed one of his best of albums. It had 24 songs. I came out with 24 songs to choose from. Like,
oh yeah,
it was impossible to bring it down to 10 for Merle, but we did, and we both did 10, but we ended up having 5 that were the same. So I was like, fuck it, let's just do a top 15.
Yeah,
so
that's perfect.
We're gonna do a top 15 now. But before we do into that, we were gonna kind of do like a biography thing. Like, we actually wanted to dive into these artists because they're dead. Well, this one's dead, so his story ended pretty much. So we could do a start to finish of his life, but then we're like, we don't have time to research this. We're not very good. I was never good at writing reports in college or high school, so me doing that would be stupid.
Yeah, I feel like I could do a good job if I had not the job all day.
Your actual job.
That I then come home and do this. But yeah, I'm excited to talk about Merle. If this is your first time joining us, you are not aware of the fact that I have a Merle Haggard tattoo, but now you do. And so it's just exciting. So obviously, Merle means a lot to me. He means a lot to a lot of people. I know it means a lot to you too, Steve.
I don't even like him.
Yeah, but
no, that kind of sucks. Yeah, fuck
it's
that guy.
It's pretty bad. I was just hoping we'd do Luke Bryan this week.
Yeah, but I mean, like you said, we're not really doing a whole autobiography type deal. Autobiography would mean that I'm writing it and I'm Merle, and that's wrong. but... Yeah. We're going to talk about some random things that he did do, which is cool. But just first of all, just wanted to put it out there. I have a Merle tattoo. He means a lot to me. My dad got me into Merle. And so that always, you know, that's always how I feel when I listen to Merle's. I think about all the times that my dad would play him and still sends me, you know, random texts about when he's brewing beer and listening to music and how, you know, you just get, no one can fucking touch Merle. And I'm like, God damn right.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And, so if you want to listen to like a biography podcast, go listen to that fucking Cocaine and Rhinestones podcast or whatever. He does it better, even though my opinion of him is not that high. Yeah, so let's just – all right, so instead of doing a bio, I just remember this article from Saving Country Music a while ago. Even though, as we've said before, we're kind of falling off that train of listening to White Knight about women all the time. He has these – he puts out these awesome articles about like 10 badass moments from these artists. And so we're just kind of – I just kind of want to read the – Merle ones because they are fucking awesome. Like, Merle Haggard was a fucking badass.
Oh, he went to jail a bunch of times.
Like, when all these, like, prissy pop country artists are like, I'm an upcoming outlaw country artist. Yeah. It's like, no, you're not.
Yeah, especially if you say that you're an outlaw artist. Like, I'm an outlaw. It's like, okay, no.
Well, yeah, it's like that's like the Waylon song of this outlaw bit done got out of hand and all that. Because it's like, they didn't want to be outlaws. They just wanted to make the music, and that's what made them outlaws. I mean, granted, they were drug addicts. And drug addicts and shit, but like, not addicts. They had drug problems.
Well, Waylon certainly he did was a drug addiction.
quite a bit. That's always my favorite when I always tell people, like, who are your heroes? I'm like Waylon Jennings, Chris Farley, just not the drug problems.
The people that died mostly because of issues. Yeah. You know,
the guy,
those kind.
The guy who
Jim Belushi. No, John Belushi. Jim Belushi's still alive. Ron Belushi.
Yeah, you know, I'm a big fan of the guy who died of a speedball overdose while with a prostitute or whatever it was.
Kurt Cobain.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. But yeah, so top 10 badass Merle Haggard moments. Number one, he was born in a boxcar.
Yeah, I did, and I'm pretty sure his boxcar home is like turned into a museum or some shit nowadays. Something like that.
It said, Merle Haggard was born in the boxcar April 6, 1937. The Haggards eventually purchased the land around the boxcar and it expanded into two bathrooms, a kitchen, and a breakfast nook.
That's so awesome.
That's funny. They purchased the land around the boxcar. That's really funny. Number two. Oh, this is my favorite fucking one. Telling off a CBS Records executive for firing Johnny Cash. So I'm just going to read this one verbatim because it's so great. In 1985, Merle released a song, Kern River. May have heard it. And it reached number 10 on the country charts. But if it was up to CBS Records executive Rick Blackburn, the song would have never been recorded at all. Blackburn hated the song and apparently went out of his way to tell Merle as much at every opportunity he had. Then at some point, Merle had enough. Blackburn mouthed off to Merle about it, and Merle lost it. He said, "That's the third time you've told me that," Haggard said. "It's more like five times. Well, I'm about five times short of telling you to go to hell." Then Haggard continued, "Who do you think you are? You're the son of a bitch that sat at that desk over there and fired Johnny Cash. Let it go down in history that you're the dumbest son of a bitch I've ever met." I fucking love that.
I fucking love it. It's so great. Like that shit does not happen nowadays. Like, it just doesn't. And that's what makes these, like, when people talk about, like, oh, I wish the old times would come back. Like, that's the kind of shit that you think about where they're just like, they don't give a fuck, but in a good way.
Yeah, and then, because it was like when we were talking to Jamie Lynn Wilson a few weeks ago, how she was saying, like, people today, they just don't have control of the music. It's people telling them what to do. And it's like, that's why these guys were out. People, always say, like, oh, they're outlaws because they did drugs and they played rockish music. It's like, no, it's because they wanted to play what they wanted to play. That's why they're outlaws. They were going against the rhinestone suits. And it's like in Are You Sure Hank Done It This Way, the song by Waylon. He says, like, how it's all same old tune, fiddle, guitar, like it's all the same shit. And so they're like, no, we're just going to play what we want to play. We're not going to suit up and be like, oh, we're the pretty boys for you. And that's what, like, when people say, like, Brantley Gilbert's an outlaw, I'm like, just because he goes brah, 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 and fucking
liking motorcycles and the Second Amendment is not all that is required to be an outlaw. Yeah.
Because,
like, what the fuck?
Granted, he still makes his own music, but it's shitty. And you know people are turning his music into this popish shit. Granted, he writes shitty songs like The Weeknd, and
but it's also because, like, he knows that that's what people eat that shit up. Like, it's not fucking it's not like he's like, I don't know, my brain is broken and I'm trying to make a point. But basically, I think what the thing is, I'm saying, despite the fact that he may control what he makes, the fact that there is a horde of people who want that recycled garbage nonsense, that dictates what he makes because he knows that he can sell it like crazy.
Yeah, exactly. And so, so that's why I love that these guys are true fucking outlaws. But yeah. Number three, watching Johnny Cash play at San Quentin Prison.
That is awesome.
Yeah, so if you don't know, Johnny Cash used to do, like, I don't know if there were tours, but he did concerts at jails all the time, or prisons all the time. And apparently Merle was one of the prisons at the time when Johnny Cash was playing.
Yeah, and I'm sure it'll be one of the later bullet points on that list, but it was, he got arrested an alarming number of times when he was young and just kept breaking out.
He says, no one knows if it's true or not, but he says he broke out of jail 17 times.
I love it.
Which is so fucking awesome. Merle Haggard's such a
Because I thought I had read that it was, he kept breaking out of, like, the local jail, and that's why they sent him to San Quentin. It wasn't the fact, like, he didn't do something so bad that he needed to be locked up for good. It was he just kept fucking breaking out, and they're like, all right, you're going to San Quentin.
Yeah. Exactly. And then number five is he recorded tribute albums to Jimmy Rogers and Bob Wills, which was just kind of a big deal because he did it at the height of his career when his songs were going number one.
Yeah.
So the fact that he was like, all right, well, I'm going to pay tribute to these guys and play their music is like a pretty big fucking deal.
Yeah, that's so cool. It just shows that he has, respect for the fucking biz.
Yeah. Yeah, it's fucking awesome. Number six, he kicked cancer's ass, so he had lung cancer, and it was diagnosed in May of 2008. I was going to say 2018. I was like, nope, he's been dead for 2 years.
No, didn't make it that far.
so he didn't like really tell anyone. He kept it on the DL, and he got surgery, and he just fucking beat it. And
hell yeah.
He quit cigarettes in 91 and marijuana in 95, but he said that didn't have anything to do with his condition, so I don't know how then. He just powered through and he kept on playing, because, fuck, we saw him 2015 just a couple months before he passed away, and he was amazing live.
That's the thing. Like, he sounded really good. That was the thing that I thought was so
amazing
about that
show. Willie was trying to stay alive, so was Kris Kristofferson, but Merle was fucking...
Yeah, Willie couldn't breathe, but Merle, his voice sounded like you'd think Merle's voice would sound, and it was great. That was one of the highlights of my life.
Yeah, that. Well, I was really close to including it on the list, but since it's barely a Merle song, I didn't. But we got to see fucking Poncho and Lefty Live.
Yeah.
That was the highlight.
That song
of that
is three
night.
Quarters Willie Nelson. That's what, another one where I don't know how true it is, but I know that my dad always would say that when they were doing that song, Merle looked at it. He's like, the song's way too goddamn long. I'll just come in at the end. And so I don't know if that's true or not, but I really hope it is.
The number seven, he did the Me and My Crippled Soldiers Give a Damn protest song, which is actually on one of them on our list. I included it because... I'll just talk about when we get to it. But he did, like, conservative-type songs, and so it was awesome that he just sang these songs to try and shed a light on veterans and stuff, and it's fucking awesome. Number eight. I don't know. This might explain it. Hold on. He recorded Poncho and Lefty with Willie Nelson. So it says he recorded the famous Towns Van Zandt song, blah, 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 went number one. No, I think it was just the fact that he never did duos really that much, but the fact that he teamed up with Willie Nelson for a song was a big fucking
deal. Yeah, absolutely.
Number nine, which is this is a great one, is helping to define the Bakerfield sound, or Bakersfield sound.
Especially for any of you fucks who think that horns don't belong in country music.
Yeah, I loved that when Sturgill put his album out, the Sailor's Guide to Earth, and people are like, horns aren't supposed to be in country music. It's like, have you ever heard Merle Haggard?
It's like, you have never listened to Merle Haggard, and fuck you.
Yeah.
Because not only do horns sound great all the time, they sound really great when well incorporated into a country song.
Yeah. So, all right, so I'm just going to read this one because it's cool. Because if you don't know what the Bakersfield sound is, this kind of explains it. As the bean counters on Music Row out in Nashville decided that for country music to survive, strings and choirs needed to be added. Then they needed to refine the sound of this rural art form to appeal to older audiences. The country music rebels out in California said, screw that, and we're slinging and... started slinging their telecasters around, playing way too loud and pushing boundaries. Right beside Buck Owens at the forefront of this movement was Merle Haggard and his hard-driving, hard-edged sound embellished by Ralph Mooney's blaring steel guitar. Not only did the Bakersfield sound keep Nashville's country-politan in check, it also showed many of Bakersfield's rock and roll neighbors in places like L.A. and San Fran that country music could be cool, and and next thing you know, you have bands like The Byrds and The Grateful Dead cutting country records. Boom. So, yeah. See, and so that's what's awesome is that it's the same with just what's happening nowadays down in Texas. It's that Nashville's doing this pop shit, but this revival, as like we talked with Jamie Lynn, like people love this music, they just don't know it exists. And sadly, I guess Nashville, I think, is just big enough that they're able to push it down, because back then they were getting loud enough that Nashville had to back down. But now I think Nashville's such a powerhouse that they're able to be like, fuck that, just shut that off. Like,
oh, it doesn't exist. Yeah, it doesn't exist. Yeah. It doesn't exist until we take one of those artists, and then it exists.
Yeah. And then number 10 is he recorded 38 number one hits. So,
my man.
My nigga. James Van Der Beek. My nigga.
James Van Der Beek.
All right. Oh, so, man, let's hop into the top 15 Merle Schmagerjmo.
Schmishmo.
Uncle Schmishmo. Number 15, Working Man Blues.
But I keep my nose on the grindstone, work hard every day. Get tired on the weekend. After I draw my payment, I go back working. Come Monday morning, I'm right back with the crew. I drink a little beer that evening, sing a little bit of this working man blues.
He's got a lot of songs like this, and like some other ones that we're going to talk about, where it's just, this is what a simple beer drinking country song should be like. Like, there's so many songs nowadays that are just like, let me list off all the nonsense words that I can about, you know, being country. This one, it just feels like he is actually singing about working people, for working people, and like kind of as a working person. Shit, he was going to jail so much back in the day that he was just like, he would work actual jobs and do labor and shit. And I just love the drink a little beer in taverns and sing some of them working man blues. It's just, beautiful.
I let the comments slide and I didn't really reply to it when we were talking with Jamie Lynn Wilson, and she said how pop music is for younger kids and like country's for older people, and so obviously now they're blending, so they're making country for younger people. And that's what I was thinking about. Like, people are like, well, there's always been drinking country songs. I'm like, yeah, but drinking country songs nowadays are about spring break, whereas drinking country songs back then were about you get done with your job and you go to a bar to relax and let the steam out of your
exactly apartment. And you worked hard all day, and now you're gonna just, you know, like he says, have some beer at a tavern and just kind of decompress. And it's just, you know, and you could say that I'm being hypocritical. It's like, oh, it's just because it's Merle that whatever. I'm like, no, fuck you, it's great. I love it.
And it's like all of a sudden I point this out, I mean, it might be because we're suburbanites, but like country music, what's on the radio, it sounds like what rich white kids listen to, not hardworking blue-collar people.
Exactly. Country
not
music.
That, not that hardworking blue-collar people don't listen to pop music.
Yeah,
I'm
country
sure
music nowadays, the modern shitty pop music is
sorority
what,
country.
It's what a rich person thinks that poor people would want to hear.
Yeah.
But it's not actually what they want to hear.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's just shit, and Merle Haggard's better.
Fuck yeah.
Next is number 14, Today I Started Loving You Again.
Today I started loving you again. I'm right back where I've really always been. I got over you just long enough to let my heartache mend. Then today I started loving you again. What a fool I was to think I could.
Good old.
I wrote this song
breaker
for you, Kevin. No, I do like it because I don't know if I've heard the song. I've heard a shit ton of Merle songs, but I forgot about this one before listening to it again today. And I was like, forgot how fucking amazing of a heartbreak song this is.
Oh, yeah. It's just where he's talking about how he finally got over her just long enough so that the feeling of loving her could come back in and just wreck him completely. Yeah. And it's just like, oof, that's powerful. Yeah.
Yeah, because, I mean, everyone's had that feeling of where you're like, you're, it's like the early stage of getting over someone where you're like, I'm over them, but then someone says their name and you're like, oh, God.
Exactly. That is what this song is about.
Yeah. Yeah, it's so great. Next is 13, The Bottle Let Me Down.
Tonight, the bottle let me down. And let your memory come around. The one true friend I thought I'd found. Tonight, the bottle let me down.
This is just another one of those classic, like, heartbreak-type drinking songs. Hold on. I wanted to look up the lyrics, because I remember there was one lyric in this song that I loved, but I forgot what it is, because I'm an idiot.
Twice. Double idiot.
Oh, yeah, because it was the, it's like talking about how kind of like drink is not really helping. So it goes, the one true friend I thought I'd found tonight, the bottle let me down. Like, I just love that lyric.
That is a great line.
Which is, it's funny because I just realized that's like the opposite of that stupid fucking Luke Combs songs of beer never broke my heart or whatever. But
yeah.
But yeah, this is one of those that I just fucking love.
Oh, absolutely. It's a classic.
Yeah. Number 12, Okie from Muskogee.
And we don't make no party out of loving. We like holding hands and pitching woo. We don't let our hair grow long and shaggy. Like the hippies out in San Francisco do. And I'm proud to be an Okie from Muskogee. A place where even squares can have a ball. We still wave old glory down at the courthouse. And white lightning's still the biggest thrill of all. Hey, leather boots.
I was actually surprised you didn't have this on your top 10.
Well, so I was going to say, the reason I don't have it on my top is because it's too, the lyrics are too
specific.
Just being a goody-goody and like, you know, and like, oh. He's not really, like, I feel like the lyrics of this song aren't really genuine to who he was as a person and like how his whole career went. Especially, like, I love there was a quote. Someone asked him about it like years after this song, or he's just like, you say in that song, you know, you don't smoke marijuana in Muskogee. How do you feel about that now? He's just like, I don't spend too much time in Muskogee anymore. And so like, it's that kind of stuff where he's just like, you know, we don't do this, we don't do that. It's like, I get it. And I mean, it is a good song as a song, but like there's too much of the, we don't do all this stuff, because it's like, I don't want it to be like, we think we're so much better, because it seems like obviously the song is about like not being a fucking degenerate, but it's also like, okay, well, some of the things that you're harping on are kind of like, well, what's wrong with that? Like growing the hair too long, like, fuck it. Willie Nelson, your bro, has long braids and smokes all the time. Like, come on.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, or it's like, yeah, we don't grow our hair out like those hippies. It's like, you hang out with Willie.
And
Willie
you
has
live
the longest braid
in California.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's really the only reason that I mean, also just because there's so many Merle songs that are great that it's kind of like it's slid down my, like, obviously I don't hate it at all. But it's slid down in terms of where I'd rank it on a top thing. It'd probably be top 20, but somewhere in there.
Yeah. Remind me that after we finish this top, I want to close on Merle again, because I want to talk about his legacy kind of after his death and how Nashville's shat on it.
And I would totally forget to remind you, but okay.
Yeah, I'll try to remember. But next is number 11, I Can't Be Myself.
I can't be myself and be what pleases you. And
down deep inside, I don't believe that you'd want me to. And it's not my way to take so long deciding that I can't be myself when I'm with you.
I love this because it's kind of, you know, the if you've known Montgomery Gentry, like, she couldn't change me type song where it's this whole I can't be myself around you because you want to change this and that about me. And it's like, I no, like, I'm not changing.
But it's also got like a sadness to it.
Yeah, exactly.
Different than the Montgomery Gentry song.
Yeah, it's not like the sarcastic smug song. It's like I can't be myself.
Yeah, he's actually feeling, you know, introspective and down about his situation. Mm-hmm. It's like, oh, that's oof.
Yeah. Yeah, I love it. I don't have much else to say about that. I just remember I heard it today, and it wasn't even on my mind when I was thinking top 10, but I heard it. I was like, this is like a beautifully written song, like a really gorgeous type ballad. And so I was like, yeah, I got to add that one. But next is number 10, I'm a Lonesome Fugitive.
I'd like to settle down, but they won't let me. A fugitive must be a rolling stone. Down every road, there's always one more city. I'm on the run, the highway is my home.
Yeah, this is one that I was kind of briefly mentioning before, that he's got certain song types that he dips into that well multiple times.
Yeah.
And this is one where...
Like John Moreland in Oklahoma?
Oh, yeah. Well, and like we said earlier, he went to jail a fuck ton. And so he's got a lot of songs like this where he talks about, like, you know, being either, you know, wanted or being formerly, you know, now out of prison or being in prison. And so it's just one of those songs about how, you know, society... looks how they look at you when you are that kind of person, and like there's nothing you can do about it. And so like he's just a lonely human. And one of my favorite songs, which is going to be later on down the way, is one that I'll get into that a little bit more on, but
moron.
But it's a good song. That's what you get.
To the audience, I was very sick this weekend, and I have bad asthma and allergies, so those things just took effect when I got sick, so now I can't breathe.
Asmergies.
Yeah, I love it. Where are we at? Number nine, The Fight Inside of Me.
Yeah, walking on the fight inside of me. Running down with life, I'm fighting and fought to die. If you don't love it, leave it, let this song I'm singing be a warning. You're running down my country, man, you're walking on the fight inside me.
This was the one I was kind of referring to quickly when we were talking about the veteran one earlier. That fact is, I love this because it's this awesome conservative type, proud to be an American type song, but it's not hokey.
Yes.
Like they're like, if you listen to like Toby Keith's Angry America, Courtesy of the Red, White, and Blue, whatever, or like American Made or what, Made in America.
Yeah,
like,
don't get me wrong, songs, I love those songs.
Oh yeah, I do. Yes. But they're so hokey. Whereas this is like an actual like good song. Like, it's not over the top, but it's like a proud to be an American type song.
Exactly. He's acknowledging that there's this side to him that exists, and it exists in a lot of people. And when people, you know, like he says, you're stepping on the fight inside of me, like he's talking about how, like, you're not recognizing that this exists, this patriotism and this desire to fight for what we believe in. Like, that's not gonna go away. It's part of us, and it's really cool.
Yeah. I love this song. It's America. Number eight. I don't know if you'll hate me for adding this one, but The Way I Am.
The way I am don't fit my shack.
harbor dancing. So I just dream and keep on being the way I am.
Oh, I certainly will not. I didn't have it on mine, did I?
Oh, no.
Yeah, I literally only didn't put it on there because of the fact that it's also Cody Jinx recorded it later, way later, and I really love Cody Jinx's version, and so yeah. I end up listening to the Jinx version a lot more.
Yeah, well, because I also knew because you probably wouldn't, because the how like I did I'm Not the Devil was one of my favorites by Cody Jinx, but you like the Warwick Davis one more.
Yes.
So I knew you'd probably do that because you probably like the Cody Jinx version better than this.
Exactly.
One.
And it's like absolutely nothing against Merle. Obviously he's tremendous and it's his song, so that's also why it's amazing. But yeah, I just, when I hear Jinx sing it, I just like it a little better. And so I listen to that version better. But it's a great fucking song.
What I like about this one though is that it does sound like Cody Jinx just does the song justice. Because, like, it sounds the same just sung by Merle Haggard, whereas, like, the biggest one I think of is Mental Revenge by Waylon, where there are two different sounding songs, his and Jamie Johnson's. They're completely different sounding. But this one, it just sounds like Cody Jinx on stage was like, let's just sing this Merle song.
Yes, we'll make it sound the way that he did it, which I think is great. But, yeah, I love this song. It, you know, talks about, you know, not being happy in life, just like with your job and just the way that you're doing things, and just like daydreaming for just being out and like fishing on a riverbank. It's just, I really dig it. And it's just, and he, you know, Merling it up.
Merle, Durl and Merle. number 7, If We Make It Through December.
If we make it through December, everything's gonna be all right, I know. It's the coldest time of winter, and I shiver when I see the falling snow. If we make it through December, got plans to be in a warmer town come summertime. Maybe even California. If we make it through December, we'll be fine.
This is about Y2K.
Yeah, if the robots don't attack, we will have made it.
I like it because it's a Christmas song, kind of.
You shut your face. No, it's because I think I'm pretty sure. I mean, I could be wrong because I'm an idiot and my brain is tired. But I'm pretty sure it's a thing that would not exist nowadays for most people to even comprehend. But he's talking about like if we make it through December in the like literal survival, winter is coming kind of sense, and like they have to do things, and like because he does reference like Christmas and like having, you know, being able to afford things for the children and family or whatever.
Yeah.
And like all that stuff, but it's just like hardship on top of the fact that you're just like literal surviving.
Yeah. Exactly. And it's fantastic. Number 6, Branded Man.
I'd like to hold my head up and be proud of who I am. But they won't let my secret go untold. I paid the debt I owed them, but they're still not satisfied. Now I'm a branded man out in the cold.
This song is about joining a fraternity and just branding those letters right on your back.
Fraternities in the South.
Yeah.
This is what I was referring to when we were talking about Lonesome Fugitive. But this song I really love. And it's just, he just talks about how, you know, after being out of prison, he just has that brand on him forever. And so, like, if you try to find work or do anything and you say that you're an ex-con, it's just everyone looks at you differently. And so, like, the line about, like, I'd like to hold my head up and be proud of who I am. But then everyone's just, like, always trying to keep him down. And it's just a really interesting song about how, like, people want to judge me and they don't even fucking know me. And, like, I can't even be proud of doing anything anymore because of the way that, that the world is looking at me. I think it's a really neat song.
Yeah, it's a fantastic song. Number five is one we've talked about before on this podcast, is Misery and Gin.
But here I am again, mixing misery and gin, sitting with all my friends and talking to myself. I look like I'm having a good time, but any fool can tell that this honky-tonk heaven really makes you feel like hell.
I love it. It's very sad. About, well, Misery and Gin. I bet from the title you can tell that it's about being sad and drinking.
Kevin, it's a song about his favorite movie and alcohol beverage.
Yes, I very much enjoy the breaking of kneecaps and the alcohol gin.
Yeah. Gin is disgusting. And anyone who says different is wrong. You are wrong. It is bad. Except for the one time, I don't know if I told the story on the podcast, but there was the time in college when I was quite, I don't know if you guys know this, I was quite an alcoholic in college. I was like tired from work, I think, because I think it was when I was living out there. I had graduated, but I was still on the lease, so I was just working out there. And I got done working, I was tired, so I was like, I'm just going to do some Red Bull vodkas to wake up, because I need to wake up so I can go out and drink, because I have to drink, because alcohol.
Because it's a
day. And so I bought, any day that ends in Y, I was drinking in college. That's not a lie, people. I'm not up talking myself. I was an alcoholic in college. But I remember I bought New Amsterdam and Red Bull. I was like, there we go, Red Bull vodkas, let's do it. Get home, realize I bought New Amsterdam gin and not vodka, but Red Bull gin. Actually not the worst thing I've ever had.
Well, it's also because Red Bull is such an aggressive flavor that it kind of drowns everything else out.
Yeah, exactly. I was like, I don't recommend it to people. I wouldn't say do that instead of Red Bull vodka, but it wasn't bad.
Yep.
But gin is not good.
No thanks. But being sad and listening to this song is good.
Yes. Gotta listen to the sad songs to make you feel sadder.
Yeah, but I think my favorite song is my favorite line is where he just, you know, says, "Here I am again, drinking misery and gin." You know, I can't think of the line because my brain is broken. But he says, you know, he's in a crowded bar full of people, but you know, around with all my friends and talking to myself. He's just by himself, sad in his own little world.
Yeah. And, all right, into our top four. If you don't know these four songs, you've just failed as a country music
fuck
fan.
You.
Number four is Sing Me Back Home.
Let him sing me back home with a song I used to hear and make my old memories come alive and take me and turn back the years and sing me back home before I die. I recall last Sunday morning.
I fucking love this song.
Yeah. Another one about the prison and the prison. And
it's just so, it's so great because it's just like marching down that kind of aisle of Dead Man Walking, and he just goes, one last thing, please let my guitar friend sing me this song. And it's just this gorgeous song about a guy who knows he's going to his death, but he's just like, I just want to hear this song one more time.
Yeah, I love it where he just, you know, sing me back home, because at least in his head he can be free for a brief moment.
Yeah, it's fantastic. These top four, it was impossible to choose kind of which one went where in my list. Because, this is my top four of my list.
Four.
not in this order, but but I'm happy either way. Number three is I Think I'll Just Stay Here and Drink.
Could be holding you tonight. Could quit doing wrong, start doing right. You don't care about what I think. I think I'll just stay here and drink. Hey, button you down, don't square no deal. Least you know the way I feel. Take all the money in the bank. Think I'd just stay here and drink. Listen close and you can hear that loud jukebox playing in my ear. Ain't a woman gonna change the way I think. Think I'd just stay here and drink.
This song is great because of the lyrics and because of the jamness. After every verse, this, it just has the saxophone solos and
this
stuff.
This is the country drinking song.
Oh, yeah.
The country drinking song. And it is so tremendous. I would have to say this is probably the Merle song I have listened to most, if I had to guess.
I mean, we've thrown this song on thousands of times, being
so
up in Hayward
perfect.
On the jukebox everything.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. 100%. And, like, I even love the cover by Jason Cassidy on his album.
Oh, yeah. His version is very good.
Yeah.
I but mean, obviously this is but much the better. Original is just, oh.
Yeah.
Perfection.
Is, yeah, so great. So, if you don't know, this lyrics themselves are like, should be home with this girl who I kind of got in a fight, and she's like, I think I'll just stay here and drink. And it's just like,
exactly.
It's such a great, I mean, now it's kind of a cliche of sitting at a bar drinking all your pains, but this was not an unoriginal comment or lyric at the time, and it's so great. Number three,
two.
I'm looking at the wrong,
two. God damn it.
I was looking at my list, and I was looking at your list. I was like, Brandon, man? No, we already talked about that. Number two, Mama Tried.
I turned 21 in prison, doing life without parole. No one could steer me right, but Mama tried. Mama tried. Mama tried to raise me better, but her pleading I denied. That leaves only me to blame, 'cause Mama tried.
This was my number one because I think this is one of the greatest country songs ever written. But I'm not upset with our number one.
Yeah.
But this song, if you don't know Mama Tried, what is wrong with you?
Yeah, you have to have tried your very best to never hear anything ever.
This song is mentioned in every fucking song ever written by any other country artist after 1982, or I don't know when the song came out, but after this fucking song came out.
This is one of those songs that, like, so many people, as soon as it fucking starts with "I turned 21 in prison," everyone's like, "Let's go!"
Oh yeah.
It's just fucking so
and it's
great.
It's such a Merle song of just like, my mama tried to raise me right. She really tried, but I just didn't do it. I refused to listen. Like,
and then when he comes back to, like, well, you know, it's only me that's left to blame because mama tried. Like, she tried.
Mama
to...
Mama tried to make raise me
mama
better.
Mama tries to raise me better. Yeah, it's just beautiful. Yeah, to start
it's,
with. Turned 21 in prison, doing life without parole. It's just like, all right, let's
and
go.
Then, but the greatest homage to this fucking song is Keith Urban's.
I will fight you through the fucking internet. I will find a way, and I will strangle you to death with that fucking microphone.
Obviously,
cord.
Totally kidding. If you guys don't know, fucking Keith Urban released some shitty fucking pop song where he used
what a surprise.
The infamous guitar, like, this is one of the most infamous guitar riffs in country music ever.
Oh yeah,
if not the most infamous country riff, because
it's tremendous.
Just that
wow,
and just hearing fucking Keith Urban butt fuck that song, it angers
God,
me so
it
much.
Makes I can't even talk about it. I'm just too angry.
The best use of it in another song, though, is the Overnight Success by Zane Williams, where it's just like,
oh, yeah.
Buddy, teach, learn how to play guitar, learn a few Haggard lit riffs, and it just.
Absolutely.
Number one is by far Kevin's favorite song by him,
yep.
Jingle Bells.
Jingle bells, jingle bells, jingle all the way.
I will kill you.
Number one is fine. Silver bells.
Silver bells. Silver bells. It's Christmas time.
I knew you were going to do it. I didn't even try to get upset because I knew you were going to do it.
Silver wings.
Silver wings. Shining in the sunlight. Roaring engines, headed somewhere in flight. They're taking you away and leaving me lonely. Silver wings, slowly fading out of sight. Don't.
I hate Christmas music. Okay, Silver Wigs. Yeah, this is my favorite Merle song for sure. It's just I don't know. It's just got all the feeling and the sound of like what I want from a classic country song, and then it's got the heartbreak. And it's just about him, you know. Looking at planes, it's kind of like watching airplanes, but Gary
I was
going
to say, I wonder if that song, I mean, had to have been inspired by this, but I need to look at those lyrics and see if he, like, referred to this song at all.
Yeah, because, you know, he's watching planes, you know, watch the plane fly away, and he's just, like, thinking about how his lady who's leaving him is flying away and just...
And the silver wings are taking her away.
Exactly. And yeah. It's just, he's just sad.
And it makes it kind of almost angelic in a way. It's like...
Yeah, it's really, I think it's just a really nice song. I just love it.
This song was number 3 on my list because I had Sing Me Back Home and Mama Tried above it.
Tremendous. And that's the thing with like any legend that we do, you know, after this, it's just an embarrassment of riches with the songs that they have. It's unbelievable.
I know. Yeah, it's going to be impossible to do like down the road when we do Waylon and Johnny Cash and Willie and all. These are going to be very difficult episodes to get
absolutely.
Top 10s for. And, yeah, that's our top 15 Merle Haggard songs. Oh,
don't
forget
the thing that you were going to forget.
Yeah,
I forgot what it was already.
I was going to say ever since. So obviously Merle Haggard has left quite the whole, like, the song Willie by Willie Nelson, He Won't Ever Be Gone. Like, Merle Haggard is one of the biggest pillars in country music, holding that genre alive. And just what Nashville, I know we talked about it, I think in one of our very first episodes, about how they were opening like the Merle Haggard Museum and shit in Nashville, and how they had like the Merle Haggard Award and all this.
Yeah.
And it's like, in up until he took his last breath, he told Nashville to go fuck themselves.
Yep.
Like he.
And now they're trying to ride on his name. They don't give a fuck about him or his music.
Like
they're
one of the last
to ride
things,
on his name.
One of the last appearances he made was in that, was it Rolling Stone or something, when he was with Sturgill Simpson, and like he buddied up with Sturgill Simpson and was just talking shit about Nashville, him and Sturgill both. Like, stop with this bullshit that you're doing and go back to meaningful music. He's like, I can't follow this pop bullshit. Like, go back to meaningful music. And Nashville is just butt-fucking his name, being like, no, we love Merle Haggard, because Merle.
Exactly. The Nashville trying to do shit in Merle's name is just like a shitty pop artist name-dropping Merle in a song. It's nonsense. Your fucking fans don't know anything about him, and they wouldn't even know what to do with his music if they heard it, because they're too fucking stupid.
Yeah, and then the... it's just... Yeah, no one fucking understands who Merle is who's younger than, you know, fucking 25, unless you have half a goddamn brain and actually understand good music. But they just, they're just desperate. Like, they say, like, they're paying tribute to Merle while just at the same time taking a shit on his grave. Like, they're just leaning over his grave, taking a crapping, like, we love you! Like, it's just, it's fucking terrible.
It makes me so angry, except for the fact that I know so many people who really do love him and his music and what he meant to the world. And so if we have to live through a couple shitty, let's pay tribute to him by playing that Keith Urban song, If we have to sit through that shit, I just know that there's a whole world of people who don't even know what the internet is who just listen to Merle Haggard yeah. LPs and just have themselves a time, so it's fine.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So, oh, the other thing I wanted to say is, I know I've talked about it on the podcast before, but one of the best things ever in my personal life, I mean, it was a bad day, because the day he died, it was a Wednesday, I remember, because that's when I would open mics.
Yeah.
And I remember going in, and I think it was right around when David Bowie died, too, because people were talking about David Bowie a lot also.
Yeah.
But I remember doing open mic and going up, and I just sang Merle songs, and then I did Pledge Allegiance to the Hag by Eric Church, which is a fucking awesome song.
That's the way that you do a tribute.
Yeah, exactly. And then add pop music and ruin it. No. So I remember doing that, and then I played the songs, and they usually let you play like three or four songs before they move on to the next person. But I got done singing the songs, and the host comes up and goes, "Can you do another Merle song?" I'm like, "Yeah. Of course I can.
Does the Pope shit in the woods?
Yeah, and it's the only time anyone's ever asked me, like, one more, like, on stage.
One more.
People have asked me, not on stage, to play more, but, yeah, like, just being on stage and having them be like, "Can you play one more Merle song?" It's like, fuck yeah, I can.
Yeah, that's fucking awesome. Yeah, the day Merle died and I found out about it, that was definitely the saddest I've been about a celebrity in which I've never met or know them in any sort of personal
Petty,
way.
Up until Petty died.
Until it was, that's the thing. It was him and then Tom Petty, and it. So yeah. Anyway, oh boy, I'm sad now.
I can't believe it's already been a year since like Tom Petty passed away.
I know.
I saw it the other day. Like,
I saw it on the Twitter, and I was like, "Well, I'm sad again. Time to listen to Tom Petty on repeat."
Yeah. You need to get some of his vinyls for your
I do. Player. That's a fucking great point. I'm going to do that.
And some more Merle. You got one Merle album.
But yeah, I need more Merle. I need more all of them, because Jay got me one Merle, one Willie, and one Waylon. I need to get a Johnny Cash, and I got to get...
Well, I need the one Johnny Cash. If it's not too warped, I don't know.
Found
it in a fucking desk,
yep.
So...
Yep. I think I try playing that one? I can't remember.
Yeah, I don't know.
My brain is broken.
All right. Anyway, some music came out last week, Kevin.
Did it?
Mm-hmm.
Did it really?
We probably would have focused more on this album if we didn't do this Legends episode. But first off, of course, is Eric Church released "Desperate Man."
Oh yeah,
we could probably go into it deeper next week or something.
Yeah, we can do that because I feel like it deserves some time.
Yeah, I was actually also thinking down the road, if like a big album comes out that we're really looking forward to, we could just focus an episode on it and just talk about each track.
I would like to do that, because also the fact that, like, I mean, we're this many artists in, we can't have that many more artists that we really, really care about, know? Like, there's only so much room in your brain. So I feel like we've done a good job hitting all the artists that we listen to a good amount. Yeah. We're going to hit the point where we're like, all right, I don't fucking know. So I like that idea a lot.
Yeah, so for a short review, I liked it more than I thought I was going to after hearing some of those reviews, but it's still pretty good, and he's very attractive.
I forgot about that. Yes, correct.
Then next is Heather Morgan's "Borrowed Heart." She, some of the songs are kind of popish, but then there are some that are super fucking country. Like, she has one song with Lori McKenna on it,
and it's
an amazing song. But I mean, they're not like pop, like pop pop, but they're like contemporary ish country where there's a little bit of not. It's not straight country, but it's still a good album. And she's very attractive. So
yeah.
Then finally is J.P. Harris's "Sometimes Dogs Bark at Nothing." It's a very traditional album. It's really good. He's very attractive.
All right.
That's it from last week that I found and that I really liked. So
yeah.
What else have you been listening to? What have you been doing? What's happening? What's going on?
I didn't bring it up on the beginning, but I went to Milwaukee last weekend and saw Frank Turner. He's a Englishman, and he's kind of like, it makes no sense to say this, but he kind of, like, because he does punk rock as a separate thing, but he does almost like acoustic punk rock, if I were to try to describe the sound of his music. It's very weird, but he's very talented. He's a great songwriter. He put on a hell of a show. So I was listening to him a lot, and then I actually started listening to, like, Stained and Shinedown and all the old, like, hard rock bands from the early 2000s. I got really back into that.
It's been a while.
Oh, God. Don't get me started. Stained is great.
Yeah, I've been listening to a shit ton of podcasts. Like, I posted on my personal Instagram earlier, but if you want to listen to if you like improv ones, listen to the Andy Daly pilot project or something, what it's called. He did an episode where he was L. Ron Hubbard, and they did a...
Yeah, I'm going to listen to that as soon as I have some time.
An episode, it's like based in 1960, and it takes place on like their ship out in the ocean, and it's so fucking funny. I was like crying laughing listening to it. It's because it's just like him talking about like past lives, and like there's one person who's like, I have a magic marker. Goes, oh yeah, I invented magic markers in a past life. They have normal markers, but then I made a magic. And it's just like it's just like really stupid shit like that. It's so fucking funny. Yeah. So listen to that podcast if you like funny shit. If you want to listen to something that's funnier than us, which is every podcast, like
impossible.
We are
the funniest ever.
Serial is funnier than our podcast.
Yeah, it's about Lucky Charms, bro.
Blowing my mind. That's what we should do. We should start a podcast called Cereal, but spell it like the food. That should be pretty fucking funny. And then you just do like a 10-part dramatic thing about a different cereal. That's actually a great idea. No one make that. That's our idea.
Don't steal it. We're geniuses.
But yeah, you can find us at CountryHodgePodge.com, Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter at CountryHodgePodge. On Spotify, you can find the HodgePodgecast picks, where we upload the songs we talk about each week, so you can listen to them in full, if they're on there. Sometimes they're not. You can find Kevin's picks of the week on a link to the website, or if you search on Spotify, the username Donkey Factory, one word. Also, every Friday we tweet out Friday's new music of the best albums. You can listen to new music every week. There's been like 200-something albums this year already. All fantastic.
It's been a lot.
Listen to them.
It's very attractive.
It's been a lot of music. Yeah, very attractive. You can find me on Instagram at @CHP_Clifftron. You can find Kevin on Twitter and Instagram at @CHP_Charch, where he's talking about how awesome the Bears are.
They are. If you don't want to see me go apeshit for Khalil Mack, don't follow
him on Twitter. If you could, please rate and review the podcast on iTunes. It'll help us get found a little more. The fact that our listens go up every week, it still blows my mind even a year and a half into this
thing. For real, you guys are amazing.
Yeah.
So amazing.
Yeah. So, or just follow us on SoundCloud. I think we're on Google Play. I don't know. I'm trying to do YouTube still.
I don't even know what that is.
But my computer has reset and has that blinking folder sign every time I try and upload to YouTube. So I'm afraid of frying my computer. So I'm going to take a break until I find my backup drive, because I don't want to wipe my computer, because everything about the website and the podcast and everything is on there. So
don't fuck that up.
Kind of need that computer. That's it for this week. Next week, we're going to just take a step higher and just talk about Sam Hunt next week. So until next week, I'm Steve Hodge, as always, joined by the biggest Christmas music lover, Kevin Hodge, saying goodbye, good night, and good Charlotte.